There's a cryptogam. Look at that, you'd think it was a rock. You want me to do the David Attenborough?
Hello, and welcome back to Curiosity Mine, and welcome back also to Bush Botany, the series where we meet up with Warwick Schofield to investigate some of the more unusual plants and organisms that you'll find in and around the opal fields at Lightning Ridge, New South Wales, Australia. In this episode, we're going to have a look at a curious group of organisms that you might not have even noticed before.
So we've got the fruiting body here of a cryptogam group of plants. It's a non-flowering plant. It just reproduces with spores. And this is the fruiting body that emits spores. Look at that dust-looking stuff. They're the spores coming out of it. And it's a fungus. And the fungus plant is just like cotton wool. And it's permanently living all in under this horrible dry gravel. You'd say horrible, because why would a plant grow here? Well, not an ordinary flowering plant as we know them, but a fungus that can just reproduce using spores. It lives underground all the time, with the exception of this fruiting body opportunity, and up it pops, and there's the spores blowing away in the wind, ready to create more of the fungus mycelium, which is the cotton wool-like structure that appears in the soil. So look at that, you wouldn't know that was a plant, would you? There's some cryptogams here that are totally different species. They are lichens. A lichen is a symbiotic arrangement between an algae and a fungi. There's one species here, and there's another species here which is growing up above the ground, like in mid-air. There's one there. Just here, these are mosses. This is all moss. And if I was to tip my water bottle onto that, it would be green within 1 minute, 2 minutes. This would come up bright green. These are mosses. You'd think it's just dirt, black clay or something. That is a plant, a spore-bearing plant. All of this is moss. If we tip cold water on that right now, it would be green when we come back in a very short time. Next time it rains, that'll be all green, all this surface here. Beautiful mosses.
All of these odd things are part of the cryptogam group, which is a wide grouping of plants or plant-like organisms that reproduce without using seeds. The word cryptogam comes from the ancient Greek kryptos, meaning hidden, and gameo, meaning marriage, which is a kind of prudish way, I guess, of saying that these organisms reproduce without using seeds. Cryptogams play an important role in the ecosystem as they do a lot of work to bridge the gap between lifeless sand and rock and fertile, nutritious soil that encourages the growth of proper plants and trees.
Right, so up here you just have your natural top soil, which is a very thin layer. It's made up mainly of organisms, plants we might call them, but not flowering plants.
The environment at Lightning Ridge is semi-arid. It's pretty close to being a desert. The soil at Lightning Ridge generally comes in three kinds. There's the dry red sand, which you'll find directly around the ironstone ridges. It's the iron that gives it the red colour. There's superfine black soil, which you'll find out on the flat plains. That's the stuff that you'll get your car bogged in if there's a millimetre of rain anywhere within the electorate. And then there's the pale pink or white opal-bearing clay on the opal fields themselves, in areas where the claystone might be near the surface, or maybe it's been disturbed by opal mining. The black soil from the plains is relatively fertile soil, but the other two kinds, the iron-rich sand and the opal clay, are not very fertile at all. So over a lot of the surface area of the opal fields and nearby, all of the soil nutrients are concentrated in a very thin layer on the surface, thanks largely to cryptogams.
They have adapted to live just in that top few millimetres in this dry, semi-arid climate. And they reproduce with spores and with little hyphae, little roots and things that grow underground. Some of them might have a leaf that appears on the surface, but no stem. And some of the plants in this group are things like algae, fungi, yeasts, bacteria. And then we could bring into that viruses, nematodes, there are little microorganisms, there are little invertebrates. And this whole lot is what makes up the living structure of a real soil. Soil is not just sand or clay, it's all these things living as an ecosystem. And usually they'll be down 100 mil, 200 mil into the soil. But here, soil is a bit of a rarity. It's too dry, too hot, there's not enough weathering to happen. It's this very, very thin layer that produces the organic chemicals, that lives on and recycles the organic chemicals as a whole ecosystem, which is the soil. Millimeters only. From that, some grasses, ferns may grow, still producing spores, not flowers. Then maybe some grasses, which are flowering plants, and smaller wildflowers, little daisies, then shrubs, and eventually trees. So this is called a natural succession, where we start with bare rock, and these cryptogams get to work, get the organic cycle started. And when in this dry climate, this very fragile situation, if that thin layer is disturbed, the in gets the wind, in gets the rainstorms, washes everything away, and we're back to the bare dirt, bare rock, nothing will grow. And right here we can see where the cryptogam layer has been disrupted with the passage of a road, and you can see the edge, look, it's only millimetres thick, this material, but have a look once it washes away for this track that we're on. We've lost the soil structure, and look at the ground, it's bare, because there's no organic activity, and you must have that. A good example of the cryptogam layer and where it's been disrupted.
So these weird little organisms form an important but very fragile part of the ecosystem. And when things go bad for the cryptogams, things can also go bad for the rest of the environment. Now, we've tried to focus this series of videos on plants and organisms that are significant to Lightning Ridge, to the local area and to opal mining. And also we've tried to focus on plants that have a relationship with opal mining. Sometimes that relationship is a positive one, like the use of renewable cypress pine for props in underground opal mines. We've looked at props in previous videos, but sometimes the relationship between the plants and the opal mining might not be so symbiotic. And that has been the case in the past when it comes to cryptogams.
Opal miners were required to rehabilitate their site always. They pay a $1,000 cash deposit, and until their 50 metre by 50 metre square is rehabilitated, they don't close it down or get their deposit refunded. And years ago, the opal miner, to make sure that it was perfectly left with no old batteries and material and mining rubbish, would bring in a road grader or a front end loader and scrape the surface absolutely bare. And they would say, there, Mr. Environment Inspector, look at that, perfectly rehabilitated. And what they'd done was remove the cryptogam layer, all the yeast, algae, fungi, bacteria, living stuff, and leave it with a bare patch of sand. So these days, the miners are required to leave rocks and logs, any topsoil cryptogam material that's been moved, they stockpile it and then spread it back over the site and return the organisms back to where they were in the beginning.
But over time, lessons have been learnt and improvements to processes have helped to protect these vital and very strange little organisms to ensure that the natural environment will remain healthy and relatively undisturbed for the future. It's good to look after the cryptogams. They're weird and they're important. Before we finish this one up, let's just talk a little bit about the difference between cryptogams and cryptograms, because the words are really quite similar. One of them is a group of algae, fungus, and ferns that we've just looked at, and the other is a kind of puzzle or code where the letters get switched out for other letters in what's called a substitution cipher. Generally, you would figure out which letters represent which other letters, and that way you would solve the puzzle. You might have seen puzzles like this in puzzle books or maybe in the newspaper. Do they still do puzzles in newspapers? Do they still do newspapers? Where cryptogam is from the ancient Greek kryptos, hidden, and gameo, meaning to marry, cryptogram is also from kryptos, meaning hidden, and gramma, meaning word. So cryptogram means hidden word. But you have to admit, it would be pretty easy to get the words cryptogram and cryptogam confused, right? It's not like there's ever been an awkward instance of a major government confusing these two things in the midst of, you know, one of the most significant covert operations of a world war. Surely not. Well, if you believe viral articles shared on social media, there was. Supposedly, and that's supposedly with a very big asterisk, during the Second World War, the British government code and cipher school brought in a very confused specialist by the name of Geoffrey Tandy to work at Bletchley Park on the Enigma project to reverse engineer the German Enigma machine. The Enigma machine, if you're not familiar with it, was basically a lot like a typewriter. but it used a bunch of complex mechanisms to turn whatever you typed into it into a bunch of random letters that would then be decoded by someone at the other end who had another Enigma machine and knew the right combination of switches and buttons to convert that message back into your original message again. Now, needless to say that working on the Enigma project had a lot more to do with code breaking and mathematics and deciphering and cryptograms than it did with Geoffrey Tandy's actual specialty, which was marine biology, focusing on seaweed, kelp, plankton, and cryptogams. Apparently someone had either misread the word on Tandy's paperwork or the paperwork had a typo in it that ended up with him getting filed in the wrong category, but either way, he was hired and off to Bletchley Park he went. Apparently, and this is where the story gets really interesting, while he was at Bletchley Park, his expertise did come in handy. His knowledge and experience in preserving plant specimens helped when he was able to help salvage the pages from a water-soaked code book that was brought up from a sunken German U-boat, and that document massively contributed to actually cracking the Enigma code, which was a turning point in the outcome of World War II. Now, is the story true? I'd really like to think it is, but there's a bit of a consensus that while the key facts are true, the narrative has been exaggerated. Tandy did work at Bletchley Park, and he did work on Enigma, but so did a lot of other people from a lot of very diverse backgrounds in science and mathematics. The Code and Cipher School deliberately took on faculty from all disciplines, provided they showed an aptitude for skills that were potentially relevant to any of the multitude of different projects that were going on at any given time. So hiring a marine biologist to work on code breaking really isn't that crazy. Some online researchers have concluded that maybe Tandy or his peers have made up the cryptogams, cryptograms sort of connection as a bit of a joke. I mean, they were British. That's kind of in line with the British sense of humour. And maybe it's just something that got stuck and has been stuck for decades. But I think the moral to the story is still very appropriate. You should never underestimate a marine biologist. This video was made with the help of Warwick Schofield, with assistance from Margaret Schofield and Kay Wotherspoon. If you enjoyed this video, please consider sharing it with your friends and maybe subscribing to Curiosity Mine on YouTube and following along on all of the usual social media channels. The links are in the description, and thank you for watching.